Welcome to today's program. Cutting Edge Climate Law Eugene is ground zero. Oregon's on the front lines when it comes to compelling science-based government responses to the climate crisis. Both scientific consensus and widespread public opinion agree on the need for action now. Two of Oregon's leading climate policy experts, both based in Eugene, will discuss their efforts to improve local, state, federal, and international responses to climate change. I'd like to welcome Tom Bowerman, who is the author of Climate Stability and Justice Act of Oregon. This bill was introduced as House Bill 3470 in the 2015 legislative session. Tom is also the project director for Policy Interactive Research. This is a Eugene-based organization published the Oregon Values and Beliefs Survey. This survey analyzed general public opinions about global climate change and how it may influence our future. I'd also like to welcome Julia Olson, who's the executive director and chief legal counsel of Our Children's Trust. Ms. Olson represents 21 youth plaintiffs, including some right here in Eugene, in a lawsuit against the federal government that was filed in the U.S. District Court, District of Oregon. This suit seeks to hold the federal government responsible for promoting fossil fuel development and its consequences. Thank you, Tom and Julia. Have a seat.
Well, it's interesting. I've been working in the legislative and administrative goals, and Julia's working in the judicial side of the equation, but these things are intricately woven together. So we may have, it may sound like we're going on different fronts, but we often consult, and both of us work with each other on this, but not officially. We have dedicated ourselves to this topic because of the grave risk of catastrophic loss of values that we hold dear. And they are going to fall by the wayside without collective comprehensive action. Increasingly, most people familiar with the climate issues of climate instability see this as the premier or paramount issue of our era. Some think that it's of a human existence. I tend to fall into that category. My personal strategy for public policy research is rooted in public opinion surveying, because I feel that with public support, you can get things done. Without, you can't. So we look really carefully at where the public is. I try to do very high quality research in this arena, and then leverage those findings into policy actions. We find in 2015 about 70-30% support for both governmental policy broadly and for state action on the climate stability questions. In 2007, Oregon passed a law to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to 10% below our 1990 levels and 75% below our 1990 levels by the year 2050. However, they gave no backbone or substance to that, so we call that an aspirational law or goal. And in the same year, or a year before that, California passed a law for climate stability, and they gave it a lot of substance action. That's referred to AB 32, Assembly Bill 32 in California. And they created what's called, popularly known as the cap and trade. I like to call it the cap and reinvestment policy because it has a way of collecting revenue and putting that back into the culture in the form of various policies to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And it's turned out to be a very effective policy, one that is helping their economy enormously by the creation of jobs, by many different calculations, they find that somewhere between 3 to 1 and 50 to 1, the dollars that are spent on renewable energies and reinvestment strategies as compared to spending those monies on fossil fuel, buying fossil fuels, gives, I said 3 to 1 or 50 to 1 in that range, better job and economic performance within their state. So it's not that they are returning to chilly houses and wearing hair shirts as much as just converting their economy to one that's fully renewable. By way of comparison, Oregon, with its aspirational goals, is now over 30% above its target, and California is getting very close to their target. They're within 2% of their 2020 target. So you can see that the difference of the backbone that they provided has made a lot of difference in terms of accomplishing the objectives. Phil Barnhart and I were together last fall noodling about the plethora of bills on climate stability or climate generally that were coming at them, and we had done some research on the various bills, and he asked me what my opinion was, and I said, well, I can't see any that are very comprehensive. Some are non-starters, some are unconstitutional. And I said, it's sort of depressing. And he says, well, what do you think about, what would you suggest? And I said, well, let me kind of think about that some more. And a little subsequent conversation was, let's try to look at the other jurisdictions that have these successful cap and trade policies. There's eight eastern states called the REGI states that have cap and trade policy related to their public utility, their electric consumption. And that's working successfully. California, I've already noted, California has now been joined by two Canadian provinces, Quebec and Ontario. And they are also reporting very good results on the California model. When California did their policy in 2006, they intentionally designed it to be joined by other jurisdictions with the understanding and the intent that with their size of economy, being the seventh largest economy in the world, that they can plow a pretty deep furrow that other jurisdictions often can't. And by designing it to be joined, they will increase their effectiveness and their leverage by more and more jurisdictions joining in. And there are a bunch of them that are kicking the tires. And that's what we're encouraging Oregon's legislature to do. We introduced it in 2015. It got stuck over a very controversial relationship between another policy on climate emissions called the Clean Fuels Bill and the non-climate bill called the Transportation Package, which is raising fuel taxation to pay for public highways maintenance and construction. And so we got frozen in the middle of the session, but we got a certain amount of familiarity with legislators, and the outcome of 15 was several legislators who were either opposed or tepid to the policy came around after the session was over and said that they'd really like to see this pass soon and that they have become true sponsors and believers and champions of the bill. And several of those individuals are strategically important in the legislature, and we're very hopeful that in this short session, which is fairly uncommon for a policy of this magnitude, to get much traction in this short section of session of 35 days. But Senator Edwards and Senator Beyer are both representing that they will sponsor this, and they will work hard to get it passed, and they're both strategically positioned in the legislature to be able to help make this happen. We have some resistance that we have to work on. If anybody in this audience has a influence or even just wants to pick up the telephone, one of our resistances is President Peter Courtney, who really likes to have no controversy in the jurisdiction. He's afraid this is a controversial measure, which I don't care whether it's controversial or not, but we just need to get it done. And, but he needs as much influence brought to bear for him to loosen up a little bit and allow us to get this passed in the 16 legislature. And Senator Beyer feels that it would be a good thing to do in the 16 legislature, because by clearing it off the decks, the transportation funding, which got tied up in the last session as well, will have smoother sailing during the 17 session when it's most likely to have another hearing. Now, that's kind of the background. I just want to touch on the policy for those of you not familiar with it, and then I'll relinquish the microphone. The act itself specifically provides for these key components, but first of all, it declares, it stipulates by law and makes it a requirement for an agency, the designated agency, the Department of Environmental Quality, to make it happen, which is the cap that they passed, the limits, goals that they passed in 2007. So instead of being aspirational, it gives the backbone, and the rest of the act provides how that backbone works. A major component is that it hands off jurisdiction for implementation at the agency level, and the agency commission is granted by administrative law to be able to make law equivalent to what the legislature does. Those are called administrative rules, and they have the full force of the law, as well as legislative law. The Act gives the 2007 greenhouse reduction goals the tools it needs. It consolidates a bunch of Oregon laws and rules and policies about emissions into a comprehensive framework, so it's got kind of streamlines the whole package into a more cohesive a group to make it more comprehensible and understandable. It certainly requires the application of best available science. It mandates emission reductions, which are, and this is important, real, quantifiable, verifiable, and enforceable. And often we call that emissions that are factored in on the basis of a life cycle analysis, so that there's not any skating or shell games that are being played. It recognizes that this is going to be a moving target, that you never get it right the first time. In fact, we may never get it right. It's going to be changing. We're learning new things all the time. So that it requires five-year reporting and strategic adjustments. It requires least cost implementation strategies so that we do it economically and efficiently. Those are stipulations. As I said, it requires full accounting methods for carbon emissions or life cycle analysis. It requires protections that impacts do not fall disproportionately on low-income communities. And this is a very critical part of the way that both California implements their law effectively, and it's in the process of the agency hearings and rulemaking that these are sorted out explicitly, but we have lots of working examples and recommendations to make when we get to that stage. It authorizes, but it does not necessarily require, a market-based trading mechanism, an auction program, which is what California set up in AB 32, and that's under the name of Western Climate Initiative and the Western Climate Initiative Incorporated, where the auctioning and the trading of permits that the state of California or Quebec and Ontario, each individually under their own jurisdictional name, allows emissions to occur, and those are incrementally reduced every year. So it authorizes that. And in 9 years of California's carbon cap, it is demonstrating that carbon emissions do reduce emissions, and it's on the path to decouple its economy from fossil fuel. Finally, it provides a policy framework which is supported by a majority of Oregonians, as we have seen repeatedly in public opinion survey. So we have the population behind us, and we have the policy available to make it work. It will, of course, be a work in progress going forward. But the current view is that we've gone through the long session, we got frozen out, and we're going to resubmit it again. At least that's what Senator Edwards is intending to do. And we hope very much that it will get a rapid action and it'll go through the 16 session and we'll have something to work with going forward. In closing, I'd like to correct the view that I'm the author of the act. Many people have been instrumental in its construction and its current form, and it continues to evolve as we navigate the shoals of contemporary politics. I definitely wish to acknowledge some key players, including law student Gordon Levitt, lawyer Dan Galperin, our Children's Trust, counselors Nate Bellinger and Julia Olson, and many other people too numerous to mention. Also, and certainly not least, at the political level, special recognition to our representatives Phil Barnhart and Peter Buckley, and Senators Chris Edwards and Lee Beyer, and certainly all the Wayne County legislators. Our legislative caucus is unified on this, and we're very lucky to have a group of legislators in our own jurisdiction that are so much behind this policy and our actions to address this issue. Thank you very much.
See if I can get this sound right. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for the opportunity to be here today. So I want to start by having you sit back for a moment and pretend that I am a federal government official. Okay, I'm the federal government, I represent the federal government. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk around and I'm going to lock all the doors in the room. And slowly I'm going to infuse the room with more and more carbon dioxide so that it becomes harder for you to breathe and for your body to do what it needs to do. And eventually we're going to run out of water here and we're going to run out of food and you're going to get hungry. And some of you will die in this room. And others will be knocking on the door trying to get at the limited, scarce resources that we have left in this room. Now, if I were the federal government and I were doing that to you, I'd like you to show by a raise of hands how many think that would be a violation of your fundamental constitutional rights. So for people listening on the radio, their room was full of arms in the air. That is, in essence, the equivalent of what is happening to our nation and to our planet right now. And I think we would all agree that when the government knowingly implements policies and practices and takes actions that irreversibly interfere with our basic life support systems, that that is a violation of our constitutional rights. So sometimes before we can move forward, we have to look backward in time. So I'm going to take you back to a few key moments in history before I talk more about the urgent local, state, and federal legal actions that are in play right now. So let's go back 50 years ago to when the White House issued this report on restoring the quality of our environment. It's a report about pollution. There is an entire chapter in this book dedicated to talking about atmospheric carbon dioxide pollution. 1965, that was 50 years ago. In this book, the federal government said that we were threatening our climate system, that the acidifying and rising seas that would ensue if we continued to burn fossil fuels would threaten our planet. So jump forward from 1965 through the ensuing decades, and that knowledge became more clear and more definitive and more precise. So that by 1986, Republicans in Congress, under a White House that was Republican leadership, Congress was Republican leadership in 1986, they wrote a letter to the United States Environmental Protection Agency that said, through ignorance or indifference or both, a very real possibility existed that we were, quote, irreversibly altering the ability of our atmosphere to perform basic life support functions. 1986. The Senate Committee on Environment and Public Works insisted that the United States must take a leadership role. They asked EPA to develop a specific plan with specific policies for the United States to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions at levels that would do its part to stabilize atmospheric carbon dioxide at 350 parts per million. They called for that in 1986. Indeed, by 1990, EPA prepared this plan with these specific policies. So 25 years ago, we had a national plan to stabilize carbon dioxide at the level that scientists now tell us is the safe maximum level of atmospheric carbon dioxide, which is 350. That plan was never implemented. Instead, for two decades, the United States implemented policies and practices that accelerated the extraction and consumption of fossil fuels, and thus the emissions and additional carbon dioxide pollution that press our climate system to the brink. As a substantial result, these federal decisions and policies, atmospheric carbon dioxide now exceeds 400 parts per million. You know the impacts you're already experiencing from these unsafe levels. I don't need to go into them. But what you also know is that this is just the tip of the iceberg, and that we will consign future generations to a broadly uninhabitable planet if we don't change this business as usual practice. So the scientific prescription that we're fortunate to have from the top scientists around the world is to restore our atmospheric carbon dioxide levels to 350 from 400. We need global emission reductions today that are approaching 7% per year. If we wait 5 years to 2020, the emission reductions need to be at an annual rate of 15% per year. Had we begun 10 years ago in 2005, we could have reduced at the level of 3.5% per year. You can see the trajectory that we're on. So through three decades of government knowingly promoting enormous fossil fuel consumption, we're now at the cusp of locking in these impacts that interfere with the basic life support function that the atmosphere provides for every single one of us. And we face tipping points and dangerous feedback loops from the melting ice and permafrost, from the warming oceans, all of which are causing the release of dangerous levels of methane and even more potent greenhouse gas. So I just want you, as I move forward and talk about the legal actions, I want you to hold in your mind this concept that for three decades, the federal government had a plan in place that it could have implemented to protect a habitable climate system. And instead, it chose to promote policies and fossil fuel consumption and extraction that threatens the livability of the planet for our children and our grandchildren and future generations. So this is precisely why our Children's Trust is supporting young people like Weston here in front of the room in taking action legally to protect their rights. And it's why we believe that parallel local and state action is so critical. I really believe that Eugene is at the epicenter of this global climate response, and for several reasons. I'm going to begin with what's happening here in our local community, with groundbreaking carbon budget planning. A little over a year ago, our city council adopted a climate recovery ordinance. And the mayor and the city council did so because they listened to the voice of youth in our community who were demanding action on climate change, and they responded. And since that time, our city staff have been hard at work preparing a carbon budget for our community that's based on the best available science of returning to that safe level, the maximum of 350 parts per million. In November, the city staff will present this peer-reviewed carbon budget to our city council. And this is truly groundbreaking work. I really want to emphasize that. It is a model for what other communities and states and even national governments can do. And it's coming right out of your community. With our voice of support, city councilors here in Eugene will need to continue to move us down the path they've committed us to and transition our community to a carbon-free one that can be an example for the rest of the world. So in these local and state laboratories of democracy, Eugene is a true leader. You heard Tom talk about the legislative action that's happening in Salem that Tom's been instrumental in implementing and instituting. We're working hard for that comprehensive legislation that sets science-based emission reduction requirements to support our basic life support functions at the state level, and we are so fortunate to have the support of our Lane County legislators But we don't have time to lose. So while our governor and other legislators dally, we are also supporting the youth who are on their way back to the Oregon Court of Appeals, asking that the court declare their rights as public trust beneficiaries to have these systems of our air and our water protected for them and for future generations based on the best available science. That court already ruled once that the youth had a right to be in court, that they had a right to appeal to the third branch of government. And we live in a constitutional democracy that is not just made up of two branches of government, as our leaders would like to tell us. We have a third branch of government. And the reason is the judiciary is intended to act as a check to prevent abuses of power by the political branches. So we are confident that the Court of Appeals here in Oregon will once again issue a ruling to focus the work of the political branches towards climate stabilization and the preservation of these fundamental rights. This is also why 21 young people who understand that their future is at stake are also standing up to the deliberate and knowing unlawful actions of the federal government. And they're doing so right here in Eugene to preserve their constitutional rights. On August 12th, they filed a lawsuit in the U.S. District Court for the District of Oregon in the venue of Eugene. And what I want to emphasize about these young people is they are amazing. And they are true climate leaders. Many of them can't vote. They don't have paid lobbyists. But they have something more powerful. They have the moral and legal authority to go to their third branch of government and ask for a remedy for the violation of their fundamental rights. Their complaint tells the clear story that the federal government has knowingly caused this dangerous situation that we're in. And even with this long-standing knowledge for over 50 years that the continued burning of fossil fuels would cause this damage, and even with having plans on the books, on the shelves, you know, almost 30 years ago, they have continued down the road of fossil fuel extraction, production, development through subsidies and permits and authorizations at every level. It is time for the judiciary to step in and stop that abuse. Climate scientist Dr. James Hansen, who is also a plaintiff in this federal case, representing future generations and his granddaughter, has said, "Judicial relief may be the best, the last, and at this late stage, the only real chance to preserve a habitable planet for young people and future generations." So this case will provide the constitutional and public trust lens needed to focus Congress and the executive. Because there's no question now that the emergency does not allow for a normal political process of progressive legislative and executive actions. In fact, that very process has failed us and put us in the situation we're in today. And what the Republicans warned of 30 years ago has been unlawfully and willfully ignored. A lot of people talk about, well, look at what President Obama is doing right now, so I want to touch on that and say it to you that even with the president's strategy going into the Paris climate talks this December, and even with the Clean Power Plan, these are a drop in the bucket. They are completely inadequate to deal with the magnitude of the emergency that we face. The New York Times reported that if we added up all of the global commitments before Paris, we would still suffer unimaginable warming of the planet. The Clean Power Plan, for its part, would reduce U.S. emissions between 8 and 10% over the next 15 years, a total of 8 to 10% over the next 15 years, from 2005 levels, which was a very high emissions year. This is a drop in the bucket. And our Republican Congress, well, they would have us burn even more fossil fuels and deny that science is something worth reading. When here on the ground in Oregon, we have fossil fuel export projects coming through our communities. We have coal and oil trains hogging our passenger railways just blocks from here. We have a Canadian company pushing with all its might to build a pipeline through our forests, our rivers, our private lands, to pipe natural gas from the Intermountain West through our beautiful state to the beautiful shores of Coos Bay, In order to burn even more gas, to liquefy natural gas, to transport and export it to Asia where it will be combusted. And this project is being forced on us by the federal government. While they want to burn more fossil fuels in Oregon and become our top polluter, we are watching our forests burn, our rivers dry up, our salmon die, our oceans acidify, our farmers suffer, our ski industry suffer, people's health suffer. This federal case, at its core, is about the lives, liberties, and property of Oregonians. Because while we are a community at the forefront of climate action, we are also at the hot spot of climate impacts and fossil fuel projects. When our life support systems are at stake, the judiciary must step in to prevent the political branches from endangering us. We cannot, and I think everyone in this room would agree, that we cannot preserve all of the other constitutional rights that we hold dear if we can't protect the life support system of our planet and that our nation is built upon. This case, I want to be clear, is not about a constitutional right to breathe or even a constitutional right to clean air, although I think there is one. This case is about a constitutional right to not have our government knowingly destroy our atmospheric resource. The right not to be locked in a room where we gradually lose the quality of our air, our water, our food resources. This is a case about whether government can create conditions that make it difficult to maintain those basic life support functions. It took the courageousness of federal judges to stand up to the charade of segregation during the Civil Rights era. And it will take courageous federal and state judges to stand up to the climate charade today. And we believe that a court in Eugene, Oregon, will announce the constitutional principles that will crystallize the government's obligation to the youth and catalyze the action necessary to meet the emergency threatening their lives, liberties, and property. Eugene is where the Atmospheric Trust Litigation Campaign started through the brilliant scholarship of Professor Mary Wood. And we're now seeing victories in other states and nations. For example, in the Netherlands and Pakistan, courts are standing up and ordering governments to act on climate change. They are stepping into this fray. And here in Eugene, citizens have a deep understanding of the climate imperative. And we have one of the most aggressive climate recovery laws at the local level in the nation. We are an amazing community, and we have youth who are at the forefront and who are leading us, and who we must listen to. So I want to conclude by giving some attention to the concept that we are in an emergency. And I know that people who do polling and public surveying, and when we're doing all this messaging, we're told to talk about jobs and the economy and all of those things that will benefit if we act on climate change. And that is true. We will live better lives and more sustainable lives and be better as a community if we can address climate change. But I would offer to you that until we come to terms with the reality of the magnitude of the response we need, and we don't fear it, but we embrace it. We embrace it as an opportunity and a challenge that we are up for, that we will do every child walking this earth a disservice, and every next generation to come a disservice. And so I would ask you that we join together and not wake up in 5 years and realize that we have locked in runaway heating, but that we have mustered all of the talent and incredible energy in this community and opportunity to act. So take a deep breath, because I'm almost done. And as you exhale and as you go back into your lives and you prepare meals for your families and you care for them and you earn a living and you support your community, I would ask that you create space to acknowledge on a daily basis that we are in a silent emergency, and you bear witness to it, and you bring your intention and your action to address it, because we have the tools in this community to lead the emergency response. Thank you.
Thank you, Julia and Tom. Our first questioner today will be Rob Zanko. He is a research associate with the University of Oregon Sustainable Cities Initiative.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Tom and Julia. This is amazing work you're doing, and it's critically, critically important, as you know. I'm a research associate at the Sustainable Cities Initiative, and we have a research team of law planning graduate students, another professor and I, and we're doing a sort of post-mortem or interim mortem on how four states, Oregon, California, Washington, and Maryland, are trying to reduce their carbon footprint, specifically from transportation. And there are differences between the states, but essentially what we're finding is all four states are, well, the three West Coast states are leaders. They're talking the talk, but not so much walking the walk. And the devil's in the details. There are structural barriers to seeing the changes that we want to see. So for example, in Oregon, in the transportation sector, there's something called the Oregon Sustainable Transportation Initiative, or OSTI, that was established and funded in 2009. And by law, it sunsets this December, and there wasn't even discussion to continue funding for that. The Portland metropolitan area is doing some amazing stuff. By law, they were required to come up with a plan to reduce their carbon footprint from transportation. They've done that. It was a bipartisan effort. They want to get people taking the bus, walking, bicycling more, and there's no funding to implement that plan. And because of the Constitution of Oregon limits gas taxes being spent on highways, there's no clear funding source for that. And here in Lamb County, there was an effort that probably none of us have heard about to develop a similar plan to reduce the metropolitan area, our carbon footprint from transportation. It wasn't required, there's no funding, and it's a plan that will gather dust on the shelf. So, two-part question, each of you. Ground us in this, and first, give us a little sense of what changes on the ground we need to see here in Lane County, individual changes, business changes. And then back us up and connect the dots. If you win in court, if you win in the legislature, will that make that stuff happen, or is that a necessary but not sufficient step? And kind of how do we get from sort of the big legal legislative changes to changes on the ground? Thank you.
What I heard of, there's a lot of layers to the way that you position that. I'm not sure that I would want to say what do we need to do at the local level as much as reaching to the highest level that we can possibly operate from. It's a bleak environment at the national level. The political arena is in virtual dysfunction. You can get that from any of your Oregon legislators. They will let you know that very clearly. That's led to the work that my group has been working on to the state level. So I'll just speak to if the 3470 version 2 bill is passed in the legislature, we fully expect that it will follow the footsteps of California the way that they have been implementing. California is just about 10 times the size of Oregon. And for the sake of simple arithmetic, take one-tenth of their $2.5 billion that their bill is now spinning off for renewables, for public transportation, which you mentioned prominently. Some of their money goes into public transportation. They're building a high-speed electric rail between Los Angeles and San Francisco. That they're putting $200 million a year into that from this funding. There's many different levels of which it's working. Low-income communities are getting free bus passes so that they can live without automobiles and lower emissions that way. Conservation and renewables investments, leveraging those dollars, not squandering them and throwing them around, but using them as efficiently as they can to leverage the maximum amount of investment in renewables. So there is that part of the bill which requires emissions to be paid for. You have to pay for the right. It's a version of carbon taxation, but it's a regulatory fee rather than an outright tax. And in California, it's applied to several hundred businesses, and those are the ones that emit more than 250,000 tons of emissions per year. I think it's actually 75,000 tons of emissions per year is the cap. So the They're not going after you and me, they're going after the fuel distributors, et cetera. And that yields sums of money, which is investment to fund the kind of things that you're saying is going unfunded. And it is a tough fiscal environment for people to fund those things, but this is an avenue to approach that on many different levels.
Yeah, I would just add that the 1990 plan that I told you about, one of the important central mechanisms of that plan was putting a fee on carbon, whether you call it a tax, a fee, a price, that you have to make the pollution that we want to eliminate expensive. You tax what you want to get rid of. So I think at the national and at the state level, that's critical. Local governments have a harder time doing that. But what is happening locally is people with our city like Matt McRae and businesses like The Good Company are working on developing community planning for other ways that we can act to reduce our emissions. Part of that is reducing consumption and changing consumption patterns. Part of that is about livable communities where we can bike and use alternative modes of transportation, making our systems more efficient, our buildings more efficient. There is so much that can be done just by way of conservation and efficiency to achieve a bulk of our emission reductions that we need to achieve in the short term. So I think those are all part of the solution. I believe that we need the courts involved at the state and federal level to provide direction and oversight to the political branches and to hold them accountable. And this has happened throughout history where courts step in and they oversee processes to make sure that they're implemented, and they provide that check against the political branches. So I believe it's critical, but I think the legislation is important as well.
Hello, my name is Wesley Georgiev, and I'm a founder of the 350 South Club of South Eugene High School.
I'm a son.
For high school students like myself, it's very disturbing that our government has not acted to control the pollution that is putting our future in such jeopardy. Can a court act in time to force a government response before we pass tipping points? How do we know it's not too late? And can a favorable decision here start a domino effect for decisions elsewhere?
Thanks, Leslie, for your questions. And really good questions. One, I do want to explain that courts can do exactly what we're asking for in both the Oregon and the federal cases. So courts sit in what's called equity, and they have the ability to fashion remedies that are fair and that stay within their job within our constitutional system. So they can fashion a remedy that provides the kinds of constitutional guidance to the other branches, provides the standards that are needed, and then gives the political branches the flexibility to work and develop a plan and specific policies to protect the climate system and reduce our emissions. So it can be done. It's been done in many contexts, from prison reform to the salmon wars in the Northwest. And in the Supreme Court's recent decision this summer in the Obergefell versus Hodges right to marry case, the court said, we don't need to wait for the political process to continue to fail when there are violations of rights at issue. So the courts do have that ability, and it's not too late. I talked to some of the top climate scientists in the world who say we're running out of time, but we still do have this window where if we rapidly reduce emissions, we can stop runaway warming and preserve your climate system. And your last question, the domino effect. I think it's absolutely beginning to happen already with the win we had up in Washington State, these international cases I talked about. I think that as more judges stay on the path and use their authority as a third branch of government, the more action that we're going to see across the world.
Camilla Trapp, City Club member. Our table was just wondering what the actual basis, legal basis, is for challenging what's going on now. Are there laws on the books?
Yes, so in the cases that we have going, in the federal case, the legal basis is the Fifth Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, which provides for substantive due process rights, equal protection rights, and then we're using other provisions of the Constitution which reflect the public trust obligation, of the federal government to protect our essential natural resources. And so just to briefly describe the due process and equal protection claims. Due process says that your government can't put you in danger and make your life unsafe and then sit back and act with indifference and not do anything. And they have to protect you if they put you in a dangerous situation. There's Supreme Court case law on this. Okay. And then the equal protection principles are about young people being discriminated against because of their age. So the actions that are being taken today have significant impacts on their future. After we're all gone, they will face the music. And that's discriminatory in effect based on their age. So that's that claim. And I think probably you're familiar with the public trust principles that Professor Mary Wood has been here and spoken about, so I won't take time to discuss that.
Alan's a Lincoln City Club member since 1991. When we wrote climate recovery ordinance, this question for you. As you know, Julia, we have the staff bring back a goal to a community goal to have us be on a glide path to reach 350 parts per million. So we've done that, and because we've failed to act so far, the glide path is actually very steep to get us, like zero carbon budget. To reach that safe harbor of 350 parts per million. When I discuss this with people, they all say almost the same thing. Wow, we can't do that. We can't get there. It's too steep, it's too difficult. And seems like what we're doing is actually determining that it's not cost effective to save ourselves. I hope that's not true. But it seems we're in denial about it. And I see this giant chasm between where we need to be and where we are. The Oregon Global Warming Commission, which I sit on, has a report going to the legislature that shows the old goal, which is based on old numbers, which isn't the steep, it's the one I'm talking about for the city. And we do what was called a wedge analysis. We keep building in new programs to get us to where we need to be. And it's a good news, bad news plan, which means that by 2030, we get to the goal that we're trying to get to. That's the good news. The bad news is none of the things that are in that analysis are in place. So there's this giant chasm between where we should be and where we are, and I'm wondering how we get over that. How do we get to where we need to be? Is it baby steps? Is it interim goals?
It's a wartime effort, is what we need. And it's not going to destroy our country or our ability to have the things that we need. It's not going to destroy businesses. Some businesses will suffer, the ones who choose not to transition to the different way of doing things in our economy that we need to. But I think it's mass mobilization, and that's what's not happening. We need, instead of an all-of-the-above energy policy that Obama has, we mean all-of-the-above climate policy, where we're doing everything. And there are really smart people in this country who have put together plans. The EPA plan from 1990 is a great plan. There are people who are working on the specific mechanisms for energy transitions and looking at transportation systems. And if you add all that up, it gets us there. We have to make some sacrifices, but it's not going to destroy our way of life. So I think we need a full-on policy that does it.
There's a conventional wisdom that the best prediction of the future is past behavior. And we are human beings, and almost all creatures are creatures of habit. And we have a lot of habits that are constraining us to change our behaviors in a way. And so what we've kind of, you've heard me before, we kind of rounded that corner in about 2010 where we really had public support for moving this, and we're still kind of lagging on getting the changes necessary because of, again, habituated behavior, fear of change, all of those kinds of things. But we, just a couple of days ago in the Richard Garden, I'm sure you saw that paper about maybe by 2030, renewables, that is
solar panels will be less expensive than any other energy source. Maybe some wind in there, but they went through a whole range of very optimistic sounding developments that were rounding the corner on. The combination of pressure from one end, which is a cap, technological advancements, our willingness to think more creatively about solutions, our ability to change directions, to continue to converse and some early adopters changing. I mean, I started in the year 2000 trying to get my carbon emissions as low as possible. So I'm an early adopter. I'm at 4. You know that the goal is to be under 2 tons. When I say tons of emitted carbon per capita. The goal that our governor signed a memorandum or a proclamation for Oregon to be under 2. The Oregon under 2 proclamation. And yet we don't see her grandstanding on how to get there. But these are maybe feel good statements and maybe the articles feel good, but we are really, a lot of us, trying to noodle through how to address that particular problem of changing this habituated behavior. Lisa Arkin told me that she was getting a lot of negative feedback from the organizers of the City Club saying, hey, this is a lot of grandstanding. Everybody's making these kind of feel-good statements. And who's the losers in all of this? It's all about, how to solve this problem and we're going to do it and things like that. I think that the important thing, speaking to that particular criticism that came to me through whoever they are, and I said certainly invite them to stand up and ask that question, but who are the losers if we don't act? What are the consequences, for goodness sakes? I mean, we are an incredibly wealthy culture. Even the people in the lowest quintile of income are wealthy by world standards. And we're talking about making some adjustments. And we have a lot of capacity in this culture to make those adjustments and have very honorable and fruitful lives in the process. So the conversation that we need to have is how to make this change, not about who's going to lose. What I think the primary losers are the fossil fuel industries. And they're going to fight like hell, and they're going to scrap and fight and put big campaign contributions in the way of getting actions done, and it sends shivers up the spines of legislators who are teetering on the brink of, well, maybe I'll do it, maybe I won't. Those are the people that we need to talk to. But in terms of who's going to lose, I think that we can actually solve this problem with essentially that overused phrase, the win-win. I think if somebody asks me, I'll read a couple of bullet points from about 50 of them in terms of what's happening in California under this policy. They are turning in some very good numbers that are all about wins rather than everybody shaking in their boots about who's going to lose.
Well, you pointed out how difficult it is for politicians to say, yeah, I can convince people to make those changes. So the program we need won't disrupt people. They don't say that. They aren't willing to carry through the program we need. Only the wartime mobilization, as we know, the kind of things that were done in World War II would achieve the goals. I want, though, a reality check. We're not in World War II. People aren't going to go that far. But right now, as Bernie Sanders mentioned, the country of Denmark, we all know that there are certain countries in Europe, countries actually have a very high lifestyle, enjoy a lot of things. And they have some pretty good programs. If the United States and other countries following the United States adopted the kind of emission reduction programs that are in place and working now, would this achieve the goals that we need to avoid the irreversible change?
Well, we're not going to get there exactly tomorrow, but we can get there. Sweden is one of those countries, which I've looked at. They have their carbon price is about $185 a ton now. That's enormous by our standards. We've polled that level. We're not going to get there if we put it to the voters. We can't get any legislators interested. Sweden is at about 5 tons of carbon emissions per capita. Oregon's at 11 or 12. the United States nationally is at about 17 to 20, depending on who's doing the counting. So all of those numbers can move up a little bit depending on who's doing the counting too as a group. But trying to use the same metrics, the way I look at it is that Sweden has a very high standard of living, and you're pointing that out. They have very high prices on their carbon emissions. It's not hurting them, their economy. If you look at their balance of payments and their general overall economic circumstances, it's something to be envied. And so, yet, they're getting there.
So you are saying that if we simply applied the same amount of effort in a similar program to what other countries are doing, that this problem would be solved?
Sweden passed their, they set their price of carbon emissions at $100 a ton in 1992. It takes a while. They then revised it in 1997 to $150 a ton. We can't get agreement from Oregon voters at 25 cents per gallon. That's $25 a ton. So we're working with a different, in a different context with different people, but we think this particular bill we have is the best choice we have in front of us at this time.
Okay, thank you, Tom Bowerman and Julia Olson, for bringing clarity and vision to the City Club program. Cutting Edge Climate Law, Eugene is Ground Zero. Let's give a round of applause for a wonderful